The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist.
There is an evil empire in the heavenlies under the command of Satan, that there are powers and principalities that are highly organized. There is an unseen host of demonic powers that are determined to destroy you under the high command of the prince of darkness. He says there is a very real devil, and his objective is to rob, to kill, and to destroy. It was a very real devil that tempted Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. It was a very real devil that tempted Jesus Christ in the wilderness. It was a very real devil that will be cast out of heaven in the book of Revelation. It's an amazing thing to me that people who go to church and call themselves Christians believe in God, but they do not believe in a real devil. They believe in the Holy Spirit, but they don't believe in a demon spirit, and certainly not a demon spirit being in their church. But the fact is, the same Bible that tells you there is a real God tells you there's a very real devil, with demonic forces highly organized, totally ruthless, committed to destroy you. And that those demon powers will attack your mind and attack your body and attack your marriage and attack your finances and attack your children and attack your relationships and attack your church. And you say, "Preacher, I don't believe in hell." That's too bad. It's still there. What you believe has no bearing on reality. Fire burns whether you believe it or not. Poison kills whether you believe it or not. Fire burns whether you believe it or not. Poison kills whether you believe it or not. And hell is a very real place where very real people are lost forever and without God, whether you believe it or not. What you believe has no bearing on reality. You can't have it both ways. You can only have one chance of survival. Put on the whole armor of God and fight back. Take the word, take the blood of the cross and the authority of Jesus' name, and drive demonic goons back into the back alleys of hell, because the victory is ours through Christ the Lord. God has given you authority. Use it so that you can have victory and peace in this life in Jesus' name. Give him praise and glory in the house of God. Come out, devil, wherever you are. It's time to kick your carcass from one end of Bear County to the other. Through the authority of Jesus' name, the victory is ours. Let God arise and let his enemies be conquered. You've got to make up your mind whether you're going to be a victor or a victim. You've got to make up your mind whether you're going to fight or retreat. Paul says, take a stand and give in to no one over any issue, because you're a child of God. Church of Jesus Christ, stop whining about the attacks on your life by the prince of darkness, and put on the whole armor of God in Ephesians 6. Attack, and then attack again, 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 and crush him and drive him out of your life, because Satan is a defeated foe. Christ has given you the keys of death, hell, and the grave. You are a child of God, and the royal blood of heaven is flowing in your veins. You are destined to be more than a conqueror through Christ. Think like it, act like it, and talk like it every day of your life. What's the point I'm making here? The point is, you can never exhaust God's resources. You can never exhaust God's resources, because he can do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can ask or think. You can see his mighty power, but when he gets through, he's not exhausted. He has much more strength ready to give you from day unto day. He can defeat any giant that's before you. He can produce streams in the desert. He can produce manna that will fall from the sky. He can send cloven tongues of fire in the upper room. He can walk on the water in the Sea of Galilee and salvage you. The thing that you think is about to destroy you, he can use it for a sidewalk to save you. When you grow weary, he can make you to run like Elijah 40 miles before the chariot. When you grow faint, he can give you strength. He can send you power that you can't begin to touch. You cannot exhaust God's power. is full of grace and truth. He is of the Almighty, El Shaddai, the conqueror of death, hell, and the grave. He's the conqueror of sickness and death. He's the conqueror of powers and principalities. He's the conqueror from Calvary. He's the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's the Lord of glory, and he's coming soon with power and great glory. Take a stand means be persistent. Be persistent. Paul was writing in the time of the Romans. And in the time of the Romans, when they went to war, they fought to the last man. Which meant if you went up against the Roman legion, you had to kill the last man to get the victory. And their enemies knew that. They had a slogan that says, come home carrying your shield, or come home on your shield. Come home carrying your shield, or come home on your shield. What does that mean? That means come home a winner, or come home dead. But victory is our only objective. The Church of Jesus Christ has to adopt that mindset, or we're not going to be victorious. The army of Jesus Christ must learn persistence. Persistence is bold, it's daring, it's fearless, it's passionate. There's nothing lukewarm about persistence. John the Revelator said, I wish that you were hot or cold, but because you are lukewarm, I will spew out of my mouth. The church has lost its passion. Persistence does not hesitate. Persistence does not look back over its shoulder at yesterday's mistake. It does not suffer from paralysis through analysis. It takes bold action and without apology. Satan attacks you because you're God's child and he hates God's property. Satan attacks you because you're the light of the world and he's the prince of darkness. Satan attacks you because you're the truth and he's the father of lies. Satan attacks you because you're a soldier of the cross. You're anointed. You have the word of God. You have covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. You can take the sword of the truth of God and attack the gates of hell. You're a threat to him. Whenever you roll over in bed, every devil in Bear County gets a migraine headache. That's why he hates you. And to those of you who name the name of Christ, stop allowing Satan and his demonic goons to destroy your marriage. Put on the whole armor of God and fight back. Quit allowing him to attack your health. The Bible says by his stripes we are healed. Quit allowing him to attack your finances. The Bible says God will rebuke the devourer for your sake. He will make him give it back to you sevenfold. Stop allowing the devil to rob you of your peace, because Jesus Christ is the Prince of Peace. Stop allowing Satan to rob you of your joy. In his presence is the fullness of joy. Do you want it? Then fight for it. Do you want it? Then fight for it.
You believe God's a just God. You believe God's God of love. You believe that the judge of the whole earth will do right. Well, then he made hell not for man. He made it for the devil and his angels. And when Satan goes into hellfire, he'll deserve every bit of it. And when he burns forever, he'll deserve it. And when God takes him from the lake from hellfire and puts him in the lake of fire and brimstone, it'll be his final abode. He'll deserve it. That's his. That's his home forever. He'll scream and he'll roar. He'll get what's coming to him. How many homes has he broken? How many lives has he ruined? How many graves has he filled? How much suffering is on this world right now because of Satan? But Satan's going to hell. And for some reason, God has allowed Satan enough quarter that he's going to give him 7 years of tribulation to raise up the greatest army he's ever had. Satan's army at the end of 7 years of tribulation is unrivaled before on the face of this earth. He will have an army. Revelation chapter number 9 talks about 200 million horsemen coming from the east. It talks about a battle that is called the Battle of Armageddon. What a battle. My friend, Satan is going to be there. What happens, preacher? I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. He that sat upon him was called faithful and true. Hallelujah to God. Faithful and true. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. He's not coming as the Prince of Peace. He's coming as a man of war. When he does, it'll just be a matter of time when he takes Satan, the Antichrist, and all the rest of them and cast them to the lake of fire and brimstone. That's where they'll be forever. I want to see that happen. On Judgment Day, you are going to jump and shout for joy that you found Jesus Christ. When the angels of God are escorting millions of people, you're going to sit there and say, thank God for the day I gave my heart to Jesus. Hebrews 12:28 says, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. Our God is a consuming fire. He's not a doting grandfather sitting benignly into the heavens out of control. He is a consuming fire. He's not a cosmic bellhop responding to your paltry tips every Sunday morning at church. He is a consuming fire. He's not a cosmic buffoon. He is the God of consuming fire. He is almighty. He is all-knowing. He is sovereign. He is eternal. And you will answer to him because he is the almighty God.